Tanya Tucker drew the card before I did.
Oh, really?
And she recorded it, but she did not include it on her record.
Okay.
And I was on Capitol Records as well as she was.
Okay.
And so she turned, and so I told him, I said, I want to cut this song. They said, well, Tanya's putting it on her record. I said, well, she doesn't use it. I want to be first in line to get it. And they said, well, she's not going to pass on this song.
It's a good song, right?
It's a ridiculous, great, great song.
This is Up and Country, powered by vLiveCast. I'm your host, Sue Bonzell, bringing you rising country artists direct from Nashville. Now let's get this show started.
I'm excited that we have a Grammy Award-winning country artist in the studios today. I'm going to be interviewing John Barry. Welcome, John.
Good to be with you.
Oh my gosh, I'm excited to have you here. You're a longtime country music artist. How many years in country music?
Well, my first album came out on a major label in 93. Well, I guess the album actually came out in 94. The first single that charted came out in 93. And then the second single got in the top 20 late 93. And then the album with Your Love Amazes Me and the other two songs, Kiss Me in the Car and She's Got a Mind of Her Own, came out early 94.
Okay. So now if everybody loves 90s country right now,
like, and they should,
and as well they should, and that's due because of you as well.
You're part of
that
very small part, but there was a lot of great country music during the 90s.
So now I know that I had a CD of yours back in the day, a CD
cassette tape,
because I may be a cassette tape, I don't know. but the song Your Love Amazes Me, that's probably my favorite song. Tell me about that song and kind of the success of that song back in the 90s.
Well, it was written by Chuck Jones and Amanda Hunt Taylor. And I was the lucky guy who drew the card to get to record it. Now, Tanya Tucker drew the card before I did.
Oh, really?
And she recorded it, but she did not include it on her record.
Okay.
And I was on Capitol Records as well as she was.
Okay.
And so she turned, and so I told them, I said, I want to cut this song. They said, well, Tanya's putting it on her record. I said, well, she doesn't use it. I want to be first in line to get it. And they said, well, she's not going to pass on this song.
It's a good song, right?
It's a ridiculous, great, great song. And she recorded it, but she turned her record incomplete, and it wasn't on there.
Oh, my goodness.
So I got the song, but of course, every time I see Tanya Tucker.
You say thank you?
she won't let it go.
Oh, really?
You know, you owe me, John Barry. Don't you forget.
I love that story. I did not know that.
Yeah, she actually ended up putting her version that she did record but didn't include on her record. She included that recording on her Greatest Hits record a few years later.
Oh, okay.
I haven't heard it, but I understand Andy Childs also recorded a version of it.
So when Tanya came out with that on her Greatest Hits, did everybody go, oh, is that a cover of John Barry's song?
Yeah, but she did a good job. But you know, to
of
me,
of course she did.
But to me, it's one of those songs. The singer is not really important.
Yeah,
it's just a great, great song.
It is a beautiful song. Yeah. That's one of my all-time favorites. Now you have been Grammy nominated for that song, mm-hmm. and it has 6.5 million spins on Spotify only.
Cool.
Which is that's crazy, crazy. You were nominated for a Grammy for that song, but you actually received a Grammy. Tell us about your Grammy award.
I was a part of the project Country Salutes Gospel, and I had the song Blessed Assurance on that album, and I'm not sure who got the actual Grammy, but I got a nice certificate.
Oh,
I said, thanks for participating.
Thanks for participating.
but it was cool. I mean, I'm listed as a Grammy winner, so.
Oh, I love that. See? Grammy winner. Exactly. Yeah. Now, you also won a CMA for Vocal Event of the Year.
I did?
It says right here, for a long-haired country boy with Charlie Daniels and Hal Ketchum.
I knew it was nominated. Did we win that? Did they? Oh, did it? Oh,
see,
wow.
This is awesome.
I'd like to thank my family. And I'd like to thank Charlie for inviting me in, and Hal Ketchum for being a part of that. Yeah, that was a great day.
Yeah.
Shooting that video.
Oh, I bet.
It was so much fun. And we recorded, we did the recording of the song itself at Charlie's studio and out in Mount Juliet. And then a few months later, they called and said, hey, can you come shoot the video? We're going to do it on the front porch of the log cabin here. And we did, and Hal, of course, was there. And, And the two of those guys are just screaming, just wonderful people, and we had a lot of fun. It was a great day.
Yeah. I can imagine. I
mean, the video looks like we're having fun, and we were.
And it's real. There was no acting involved, right? No acting.
Which is good for me.
So now you've continued to make music for 40 years, 40 some years.
My first album came out in 1979. Wow. A record called Humble Beginnings.
Okay. There you go. Humble Beginnings.
I'm really glad you never heard of it. Can you say sucks on podcast? It sucks.
Sure, you can say whatever
sucks.
You want.
It's horrible. And we actually found a couple of boxes of my first album and my third album. It's Humble Beginnings and Tired of the Game. I think it's the third one. And We've been selling them online, but we put a disclaimer asking people to please just use it as a coaster. Don't actually listen. Don't unwrap it and actually listen to it.
That's funny.
It will ruin your entire perception musically.
Well, see, but that it does give perspective, though.
Well,
I mean, really, as any artist or anybody doing, I mean, even me doing these podcasts, I look at some of the beginning ones and I go, oh my God, I'm terrible. Yeah, and it's like, you know, you just keep getting
and
better,
And we thought we knew what we were doing.
Right? Oh, you still do. You still do. So now you just released a new album, correct?
Yeah, it came out this year, just in March. And it's called Find My Joy. And we release it with Gaither Gospel Music.
Okay.
And I've been wanting to cut this record for years and years. And I've actually started it a few times, but different people involved, there were different perspectives, and we ended up cutting some tracks that sounded like I should be 23 years old. And, you know, it just didn't sound like me at all. And so we just never really got anywhere with those recordings. And then I had throat cancer 3 years ago, and after going through that, I don't know if you've ever had any kind of cancer or dealt with cancer, the treatments will kill you. Cancer's tough, treatments will kill you. The radiation was really rough. The chemotherapy was the worst thing ever.
Wow.
And it literally, the chemotherapy, the radiation sucks the life out of you, drains you. And if there's anything left, the chemo takes care of that.
Wow.
And just sucks the joy out of living completely. I got an email from my manager, Brian Smith, and he sent me a song written by Steve Dorff, who he also manages. It's a song called Find My Joy. And I said, what joy? Next.
Oh man.
And I listened to it for months. Mm. And that was when I was going through the cancer treatments and trying to recover and do recovery. And finally, he kept asking me if I'd listen to that song. And no. So I finally did, and much further into the recovery. And the song really just spoke to me. It's a great song. It's a wonderful song about realizing that you're not alone, no matter what trials you're going through. Whatever it is you're facing, you're not doing this by yourself. And so it was really awesome. And Steve, he's such a great writer. Viewers don't know Steve, they should. He's written songs that are part of the soundtrack to their lives.
Yes, absolutely.
He's written songs for everybody. You know, when you look up in the Songwriters Hall of Fame, and you see all these people, and there'll be these songs they've written, you know. You get Steve Dorff, and it's like, pages. How does somebody do that? We got together and we were just talking about some things, and I was listening. I'd heard some things that he had produced, and I said, he might just get what I'm talking about. And so we started talking about putting this record together. I wanted to do something. I wanted to record this project, which is ended up being Find My Joy is a mix of six old classic hymns. Mm-hmm. And four new faith-based songs of faith, you know. And I've been wanting to do it for a long time, like I said. But coming out of having throat cancer and going through that experience and all that, it gave me an opportunity to go in with a real heart of joy to go record these songs. Mm. And we got we ended up recording Find My Joy, which Steve wrote, and the title track. Something Bigger Than Me and Live Like You. And then he was co-writer on three of those three. And there was another relatively new song compared to the old hymns, really new, a song called Blessings. Laura Story had, she wrote and had a hit with maybe 10 years ago, okay, a Christian radio. And so Steve brought, I sent him lots of these hymns that I wanted to consider. And he knew some of them, but then some of them he didn't know. He knew How Great Thou Art, which we everybody's heard that before. But there were some other ones like Great Is Thy Faithfulness he'd never heard before. And some of these other ones he'd never heard. And you think, how does somebody not hear these songs?
Well, some people don't.
Well, he's Jewish and he's from New York.
Well, then there you go.
Yeah. He said, where have these songs been all my life?
I said, won't hold it against
I said,
him,
they've been in the Baptist church, Steve. And they don't play them in the synagogue. So, but he brought this musicality to the sessions because it was just beautiful music. Yeah. And he didn't bring the attitude of, well, this is how it's always been done, because he didn't know how it's always been done. He had no right? idea. So he brought a real freshness to it. And most of the record, almost all of it, is recorded with a small band, piano, bass, drums, and a guitar, and 45 string players.
Oh, wow.
And it's just...
Oh, my goodness.
It's just beautiful. That's what I wanted. I always wanted this type of record to be an extension of some of the Christmas music I had done years before.
Yes. Uh-huh.
Big and beautiful and just lush. And, you know, and that's what Steve ended up doing.
What a blessing to be able to work with him as well. And like you said, it's probably great that he was not familiar with the tradition of it. So you could actually have some fun with it, do it a little bit differently.
Yeah. And do it in a way that was just, you know, that was just, like I said, with his musicality wrapped around it.
So, yeah, exactly. Yeah. See, this is, we're getting the behind the scenes on all the music. So so the name of the album is Find My Joy. So you guys can go look for that. It's out now. So I understand that in 2018, you became, there was official John Barry Day in your hometown.
Oh, in Athens?
Yes, June 16th.
Yeah. I've had it twice in Athens.
Twice?
Yeah.
You have 2 days? You have 2 days?
I got 2 days. The first time was years ago when my first album came out on Capitol Records. They declared John Barry Day. and then this last time, they back in, I guess, in 18, is that when it was? And they gave me the key to the city and everything. And then, daggone, they went and changed the locks.
I was going to say, you know, I always wonder, when you get the key to the city, I mean, you know.
Yeah, they changed the locks on me. What good's the key now?
Well, they're very proud of you, obviously, which
it's
is
a great.
Great
town.
Athens, that's what they should be.
It's a great town, and I lived most of my life in the Athens, North Georgia area, and that's where I met my wife, Robin, and all our kids. Our three kids were born there, and we love Athens, and it's just a real vibrant college town. It's a lot of fun.
Yeah. Well, you got to love the hometowns. Hometown's a good thing.
Good thing.
So I do want to play a game with you.
Okay.
So we're going to do a little game that's going to be coming up. But first, would you be willing to play some music for us? Maybe
sure.
A song for us?
I'd love to.
Would that be okay? Okay, yeah. Great. So legendary John Barry is here in the Up and Country Studios. So when we come back, he's going to be playing a song for us.
Hi, my name is John Barry, and I'd like to play a song for you. That was my first number one record 28 years ago on May the 10th of 1994. Your love amazes me. I've seen the seven wonders of the world. I've seen the beauty of diamonds and pearls. But they ain't nothing, baby. Your love amazes me. I've seen a sunset that could make you cry. Colors of a rainbow reaching across the sky. The moon and all
its phases, but your love amazes me. Don't you ever doubt this love of mine. You're the only one for me. You give me hope, you give me reason. You give me something to believe in. Forever faithfully, your love amazes me. Miracles never came. I got down on my knees out in the pouring rain. But only you could save me, and your love amazes me. Don't you ever doubt this love of mine. You're the only one for me. Give me hope, you give me reason. You give me something to believe in. Forever faithfully, your love amazes me. Your love. But only you could save me, and your love amazes me.
Okay, that song is my absolute favorite. Your Love Amazes Me. Thank you so much for playing that for us.
I'm glad you enjoyed it. Thank
so
you.
Make sure you go get his new album, Find My Joy. If you haven't already, you can go get that now. And you can go get some old stuff, too.
Oh, yeah.
Right?
Lots of old stuff.
There's a whole bunch in the library.
Lots of old stuff.
Lots of old stuff, he says. Well, are you ready to play a game with me?
Sure.
All right.
Let's play a game.
It'll be mostly painless.
Okay.
Okay. Well, I usually play...
Don't want to hurt too much.
You probably heard of Truth or Dare.
Oh, no.
And here at Up in Country, we play Truth or Truth. So no daring. We don't want anybody breaking an arm or anything like that.
Okay,
so,
that's good.
So I've got some questions in my little basket, so you get to pick a question.
I'm going to pick this question right here.
That's the magic one. Okay, you go ahead and read it, and then
are you answering?
No, you are.
Have you ever broken the law? Trying to get her on time.
Trying to get her on time, you were breaking the law.
Let me see, have I ever broken the law? I don't think so. No.
See, no, he didn't. He was wearing the halo earlier, right?
Yeah.
So it's like, come on.
I'm not an Indian outlaw.
Yeah, right. Exactly. It's not really your style.
Yeah. Okay. I don't do outlaw country. I'm not an outlaw.
Well, we'll do another one. How about that?
Okay. Oh, this looks like a long one here. What's the craziest thing you've done on public transportation? Oh, gosh, I'm so boring. I've never done anything on public transportation except fall asleep.
Flying or anything like that?
My wife jokes, she said, you're the only person I know that goes to sleep before the plane takes off.
Wow.
And wakes up when we land.
You are the only person that I know that can do that as well.
I said, it's part of the plan. I stay awake so I can go to sleep when I get. I will make myself stay awake until I get on the plane. Because that baby goes down, I don't want to know about it.
So you're already pre-planning.
Pre-planning, so, going down.
And you don't mind flying. Flying's no problem for you.
Well, I actually was a pilot. I was a private. I had my own little airplane.
Okay.
Love that.
Okay.
Because I'm in control.
That's a good
flying thing. Flying on a jet as a passenger, I'm not such a big fan.
No.
No.
You're a little worried about the pilots, or?
Well, it's just I don't know. It's just. Herding cattle, you know, get them on, get them off, you know. I'm not real crazy about that whole thing, but it's just, I like piloting my own little plane.
Do you still have a plane?
No, I sold it. My wife did not like me piloting my own plane. And she would have nightmares nights before going on trips.
No.
And she should have gotten her license because I got so many hours of time. Because at the time when I got my license, we lived in Athens, Georgia. And I would get a lesson up to Nashville for meetings.
Okay.
The pilot would wait for us. We'd spend the day, and then we'd get on the plane, we'd take a lesson back home.
Yeah.
She'd sit in the back seat.
And take the lesson.
Terrified.
She was taking the lesson, though, right?
She should have. Right? She should have. And then she would have realized it's not going to fall out of the sky.
Right.
And then, yes, then I would still have a plane today.
Oh, well. It's kind of like, you know, motorcycles, too. So, you know, it's kind of like, they're a little dangerous. But
let's see if we can find a more interesting one.
Let's try again.
What can I actually talk about? What's upside down?
How many X's numbers are currently in your phone? Probably zero, I'm going to guess.
I would say zero. Yeah, I've been married going on 34 years. I would say there's zero X's.
Zero X's.
Because back then, there weren't any mobile phones.
Right, exactly. So you've been married for 35 years.
Yeah, well, coming up on 34 years.
Okay, all right. What's your secret?
I have no idea. Marry good.
Marry good. Okay, that's all right. Yeah. Start with step one.
Yeah, we spend a lot of time together.
Yeah,
we work together, kind of like you guys.
Yeah,
and we just years ago, and I have to give credit to my dad and to my wife. When I had brain surgery back in 94, I turned into somebody else.
Wow.
Really bad person. And when I was going through all that, my dad really was a good listening post for my wife. And he told her one time, he said, you know, love is not a feeling. It's a decision you make.
Yeah.
And I hope that you will hold on to that decision you made to love my son through this. And she did.
That is awesome.
Found out there's a thing growing in my head they had to remove.
Wow.
And had the surgery. I woke up, I was me again.
So, wow, that is incredible.
I think that's it. It's just we got married and we decided that we were gonna love each other.
Aww.
So she didn't always like me a lot. But
right.
She loves me anyway. So.
It's, you know, certain days where you go, you know, I love you, but I don't like you right now.
I love you, but would you please go away?
Right, exactly.
Just for a little while.
Well, you obviously are doing something right. I want to thank you again for being here and playing a song for us and playing the game and sharing all that great history about the amazing country music that you've been creating for so long.
Thank you.
Absolutely. Thanks for watching Up in Country. Be sure to like and subscribe and leave us a comment. We do new episodes every Tuesday, and be sure to follow Up in Country on Instagram, TikTok, and Facebook. And you can follow me too, @SueBonzell on Instagram, Facebook, and TikTok.